Good evening, all of you. Welcome to another session on moths today. A small brief. This is actually done by Kottayam Nature Society and Alappuzha Natural History Society. We done almost 15 talks on different subjects. And today is introduction to the moths by Anish. He's a well-known butterfly enthusiast and a moth enthusiast. That's what even I like to call myself. We are not experts. But he's very good taking classes and he is very keen to study them. Thank you so much, Anish, to agree to give a talk. And tomorrow we are going to have another session by Hari Krishnan on reptiles and amphibians of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Keep watch that. That's going to be an amazing talk. Over to you, Anish. Thank you so much.
Thank you, David. So thank you, the Kottayam Natural History Society and Alappuzha Natural History Society, for conducting such an event. So I can see lot of the friends are in the list. So good evening, everybody. So today I'll be talking on the moths. So basically, I am not an expert on moths, but I think we have to start sharing or we have to start talking about moths slowly, then people will be, more and more people will be coming into the area of moths. Okay. So actually in India we have limited expertise in the area of moths, but we have a lot of potential, we have a lot of diversity, and we have a lot of enthusiasts. So and now the we have a lot of technology to connect with people, and now we can easily connect with different part of the world and different the research labs, and also slowly we can build up our moth database, and surely in the coming days we'll be having a lot of the moth experts. Okay. So today basically I'll be covering only the very fundamental things. So you may not be getting too much on the taxonomy. So I'll be talking on the basic characteristics of moths, and very basic classification of moths, and some amazing facts about moths, and some introduction into the early stages of moths, the eggs, caterpillar, or all the pupa, all that stages. Some introduction I'll give. Then I'll be sharing some the idea, some of the the websites and some of the resources where you can search your idea or where you can get more information about moths. Okay. And we'll be having some discussion on all the things which we'll be presenting. Okay. So hope you can see my screen.
Yes.
Okay. So this is actually I am intentionally made it colorful. So usually moths, when we are talking about moths.
One minute, please.
Okay.
Please unmute yourself.
Okay. So now I'm audible.
Yeah.
Okay. So I was telling. So I just made it. The colorful in this beginning, because usually when we are talking about moths, people are thinking about the dull creatures, not colorful. So they are very difficult to identify and distinguish. So so I want to just break the concept, and we'll be giving some idea about the moths, or at least I'll be showing some of the pictures so that you can see the diversity of moths, and as well as you'll be getting some interest in moths. So that's what I was looking for. Okay. So this is the just outline of the presentation I just told. So this is what I was thinking. So we'll be having some the some 15 minutes presentation, then we'll be having a small discussion. Okay, you can use this chat box also. Then we'll see, we can take some quick questions, and the remaining questions we'll be taking at the end of the end of the session. Because if I'm the monotonously speaking for a long time, it may be boring. So I'll be giving some gap in between, where we can have some short discussion. So this is the background. Okay, so moths are a very large group. So is a, you know, they are in the family or in the order of Lepidoptera. So and but I mean, we know the butterflies. Butterflies are colorful. They are flying in the daytime, and you have a lot of the frankly speaking, we know more about butterflies and very less about the moths. Okay, but the diversity of the moths are huge. Okay, at least 10 times more than the butterflies. So approximately there are 160,000 species of moth around the globe. Okay, and most of these are nocturnal. Okay, but you can see there are a lot of crepuscular and the diurnal species. So which can you which you can see at the daytime. So this is the background. So the how you'll be distinguishing the butterflies and moths. Okay, so that is the first thing usually people will be asking, because the some of them you will be knowing the butterflies are easier to know, and we'll be having more idea about the butterflies. Okay, so the first thing usually people will be asking is how to differentiate between butterflies and moths. Some of them are looking very similar. Okay, so the generally we are saying the moths will be coming at night, moth will be sitting like this, but that all are the not a reliable key. Okay, so usually the one reliable key is looking at the antenna of the butterflies. Okay, so the usually the butterfly antennas will be clubbed. Okay, at the end it will be clubbed. Okay, so whereas the moths will be having the either feathered or the very thin antennas. So that is the basic difference between them. So here you can see the top two are the butterflies, and the bottom all are the moths. Okay, so the in the bottom the left two are with a very thin the antennas. Okay, the then a big one with a feather like antenna. Then we have different types of antenna, but the butterflies usually having a clubbed antenna. So the tip of the antenna will be clubbed. Okay, so it will be like a something like a hockey stick. So it will be the that is the most reliable key to distinguish between them. Okay, so here I kept some one picture is missing, sorry. Okay, so here I kept some the moths and butterflies, so you can see some of them. Okay, so here the A B are having very thin narrow the antennas. So the tip of the antenna is thin and narrow, so that are moths. Okay, but the C, it's a butterfly, so we are looking at close, so we'll be having a club like antenna. So you can see at the top, after distinguish them, I kept a picture of an antenna. Usually the butterfly antenna will be something like that, so the end will be clubbed, so it will be a thicker. So unlike the moths, so butterflies are easier to identify. Okay, so there is a one reliable key here. So here the picture E is also a butterfly. Actually some of them it's a skipper butterfly. Okay, you can see the antenna shape, so tip of the antenna is clubbed, and F is also a butterfly. Okay, but the topmost the G is a moth. Okay, you can see the tip of the antenna. So that is the distinction. The distinction between the butterflies and moths. Okay, and the I admit that sometimes you cannot easily see them in the field, or even with a picture you cannot easily identify them. But that is the only reliable key we are having, because some butterflies may be coming in the evening time or night time, but some moths may be coming in the daytime. So with the daytime, you cannot distinguish them. Time of the sighting, you cannot distinguish them. Or with the a color, it can, you cannot distinguish them, and sometimes you'll be saying, but the moths will be sitting with their open wings, or butterflies sitting with their closed wings, and here you can see some butterflies also sitting with open wings. So you cannot distinguish with them with all these other characteristics. Usually you can the rely only on the shape of the antenna. Okay, so I'll be just going through some of interesting facts. Okay, so in India there are around 10,000 moth species. Okay, and but we have only around 1,200 or 1,200 butterflies only. Okay, so the ratio is around 9:1. Okay, so we'll be having, I mean, almost double, I mean, the 10 times the number of moths than the butterflies. Okay, but the we don't have the data on all these moths. Okay, so I mean, if you are looking at the all the databases, all the the research laboratories, libraries, everywhere, if you are searching it online, you can get a maximum of 5,000 the identified species. That means almost 50% of the moths in India are yet to be described or yet to be identified. Okay, so I mean, there is a huge potential in India because we have a huge diversity of moths, but still it is a, I mean, the unexplored area. So some of the moths which you are seeing at your home, maybe some new species to science, or some of the moth which you are seeing every day, or which you are seeing on the social media, maybe some new moth which is not described yet. Okay, so that is the area actually I want to concentrate on through this exercise or through this the talk, because this is the era of citizen science. Okay, so all the exercise only scientists cannot do. So all these natural history and all, now it is building up through the citizen science. So the every citizen has the responsibility to contribute towards the science, and the each year record, okay, if you are sharing it properly with the proper the date and time, proper documentation details, so it will be coming as a research data. So nowadays we have lot of the platform to share your sightings, so share your the observations. So once you are sharing this observation, somebody is, some experts are identifying it properly or identifying it correctly, this becoming a research data. That data the science can use. So that data will be helpful for the moth itself, and it will be helpful for the science itself. So you have the responsibility here to contribute to the conservation through this, simply just clicking and sharing the picture with the proper details. Okay, so just sharing the picture in WhatsApp or Facebook may not be helping, because that is not properly documented. But there are a lot of platforms, like the lot of citizen science platforms are there, like the iNaturalist or Moths of India. Lot of platforms are there. If you are sharing somewhere, so it will be helpful for the scientific society, as well as the moth. It will be helping the conserving the moths. Okay, so here bottom I have kept some pictures of moths. Okay, you can see some of them colorful pictures. Okay, some of you can identify the top on the bottom, the leftmost one. That's a blue tiger moth. That is what usually we are calling it. So, yeah, all these are the colorful moths. Okay, so usually these moths are appearing in the daytime. Okay, all these are daytime. Okay, so generally we are saying the moths are the coming in the night. So, but some of the moths are day flying moths, so they'll be coming only during the daytime. And you have the convention that the moths are looking dull. They are not beautiful, but you can see lot of beautiful, colorful moths also. Okay, so and the next slide you can see lot of size variation. So actually there is a in the middle, there is left side, there is a small moth. Okay, so that is a plume moth. Okay, so that will be only 1 or 2 millimeter in size. Okay, whereas you have seen the bottom pictures are of the atlas moth, so which is the largest moth in India. So wingspan will be around it can grow up to some 28 to 30 centimeter. Okay, so that is a size of the moths you can see. So there is a lot of size variation. So some of the moths you cannot easily identify whether it's a moth or not, or some of them are really big. Okay, and the most moths. So what the main the function of these moths? So you can see the this is the very close to the mean the the or this is the bottom most mean very close to the bottom of the food chain. Okay, or in the there are a lot of insects. Okay, so the the number of insects or the insects are the one of the basic elements in the food chain. Okay, and they are contributing lot to the lot to balance the ecosystem. You can see they are helping in pollination. So you can see the moths are coming in the night and they are pollinating most of the flowers which are blooming in the night. Okay, and they are helping lot of pollinating lot of flowers or lot of your cultivations. All are helping by these particular moths. Okay, and one more interesting fact I kept here is some moths are not feeding at all. Okay, so some moths they do not have even mouth. Okay, so one example is the Aphalus moth. So which you can see in the previous slide, the last two are the biggest moths. Okay, so actually after emerging it as an adult from the pupa, they are not feeding at all. Okay, actually they are not feeding means they don't have mouth at all. So during the larval stage they will be storing lot of energy to survive in the adult stage. Okay, that fat the energy will be storing as fat. So that fat they will be using to live through the adult stage. Okay, you can see that the in the adult food they will be looking to reproduce. They are not spending much time on eating and relaxing. So their main aim at the adult stage is to reproduce. So that is why they are conserving their energy so that they don't have mouth parts. Okay, so some of the big moths they don't have the mouth parts, or they are not feeding at all in the as a big moth or as an adult they are not feeding at all. Okay, so and I told this is the one of the basic element in the food chain. You can see if you are just having a walk around in your garden or in your natural tile, you can see all these events are happening around. Okay, so those who are interested in spiders, they are seeing that lot of moths are coating the spider webs, or can see the the lizards or even birds eating lot of moths, and then see even bats. Okay, they are coming at the night, lot of insectivorous bats are there, they are feeding on mainly on these moths. Okay, so this is a very important element in the food chain. So it is quite important for the ecosystem to survive. So if you are using lot of pesticides or if you are trying to control the population of moths, so it will be badly affecting your ecosystem, or it will be badly affecting the balance of the system. So the that is the first part I am talking about. So I'll just quickly take some few questions. Okay, so I just want to know how the thing, some of you can unmute and ask some questions.
So I think it will be better if you can one second, excuse me. Okay. So one, it'll be better if you can write in the chat box. Okay, then otherwise will be a mess.
Okay.
Yes.
Because if you are having any questions, you can just key in. Okay, because if
yes,
I'm...
yes, there are some questions in chat box.
Okay.
Can you see?
Okay. One second. I'll just quickly take some questions. Okay. So one is the current population of moths declining due to the light pollution. Okay. So usually the moths are known as the moon worshippers. So usually earlier we were telling it as the moths will be usually sensing the moonlight at the night, and they'll be moving towards the moon where the light source. Okay. So usually the city lights are creating some problem for the moths. Okay. So actually we are not completely studied the mechanism. So definitely we can say some impact is there on the life of the moths. So when the city light and the distractions are causing a lot of damage to the moths. Okay. But we are not completely aware of all the details. Okay. So whether you can identify the image by moths by image. Okay, some of them you can identify, but not all, because I told we are having only the knowledge of some around the half of the moths in India. And also these are very small, so the identification keys may be very small. So sometimes you cannot identify with the only pictures. Sometimes the difference may be in the underside or in some other aspect. So you cannot identify all the moths by only pictures. So why moths are attracted to street lights? I told they basically that are the lights which are coming in the night time. So usually we are following, they are attracted towards the moonlight. Okay. Is there any plants or trees which are rely exclusively on moths for population? Yes. Some of them are totally depending on particular species of moth also. Okay. So actually there are some species of moths having very long the proboscis, so that they can suck into some of the flowers are having long tubes. So the only with that long proboscis only they can sip the nectar from that, so that will be helping that particular the plant to pollinate. Okay. How can they identify two species? So I'll be showing some more pictures, so then we'll be knowing what is the complexity. Okay. So the life cycle of moths, so it'll be depending from few days to few weeks or few months. Okay. So all moths are having the compound eye. Okay. So life span of the moths will be changing from varying from few days to few months actually. Okay. So I told the identification is difficult because of we have more diversity and we have less expertise in the field. Okay. So do you have any specific host plants for moths? Okay. Yes, some of them having host plant specific, but most of the moths are little more flexible than the butterflies. Some butterflies will be sticking only to some particular plants, but moths are little more flexible, so they will be adapting to some other plants also. But the preference will be there for some moths. So that picture is not a, okay. So I'll correct it. Okay. Moth bat picture. Okay. So I'll take the remaining questions after. So we'll be coming back. So I'll come to the next stage of presentation. Okay. So. And now this section I'll be I'll be introducing some moth families. Okay. So this is some general idea about the families. So you'll not be getting the complete idea about the families, because unlike the butterflies, so where you will be having only some four or five main families, but here you'll be having plenty of families and plenty of subfamilies, and the members in the same family also may not be looking same. So what you can do is you can just start with some of the main family members, and some of them familiar moths you can club together, and you can start learning about them, or you can just recollecting some of the names which you are already familiar with. So that is the way you can slowly build up, and you keep on updating all that things. Okay. So what I am trying to do here is I'll be just introducing some of the family, and I'll be just telling some key aspects of it. Okay. And they are not, putting it as a clear section. I'll be just going with some alphabetical order so that, some modes I club together so that you can see it. So it is not a clear scientific division, but you'll be getting some idea about how these families are. Okay. So I told I'm just going with some the alphabetical order. Okay. These are the some longhorn moths. Okay. So fairy moths or longhorn moths, it is known. So the they are having some bright colored wings, and they are having very long the horns. Okay. So they are having some metallic patterns and colors, but these are very small moths. Okay. So it will be only 2-3 millimeter size. So sometimes when you are going in the field, you may be encountering such in the moths, and some of them may be very difficult to click it without a good macro camera. Okay. So that are very small. Okay. And this family you are slightly aware about it. These are known as tiger moths. Okay. So this is a slightly large the family of moths. Okay. So usually they are having very bright colors. So some of the species you may be already aware of it. Okay. So the bottom left one is known as the salt and pepper moth. So you can see the wings are having some the dots. So it is known as the salt and pepper moth. And some the handmaiden moth, some wasp moths. All these are the members of this family. So this is generally known as the tiger moth. Okay. The one peculiarity of this species is they are having all big hairy caterpillars. Okay. So usually the moth caterpillars are, this hairy moth caterpillars may cause some allergy. Okay. Some of them may be causing the serious allergies, or some of them may be causing minor allergies. Okay. So that is why people are having naturally they are not liking the moths because of all these things. They are having very ugly looking or very scary caterpillars. Sometimes it is true also some of them may be very allergic. So most of these the tiger moths caterpillars are the hairy or woolly caterpillars. Okay. So this is an interesting moth. Okay. So sometimes you may be you would have seen this particular moth. This is known as the Mandina agus. Okay. So this particular the left side, the bottom, you can see one butterfly is sitting on that plant. Okay. So this is a Crotalaria podbloror. Okay. So basically they breed on the Crotalaria plants. Okay. So Crotalaria plants are the plants where the butterflies are coming to sip the alkaloid rich the sap. Okay. So basically these butterflies are looking for that particular sap to get the some chemicals. So with that chemicals that can attract more their mates better. Okay. Usually the male butterflies will be sitting on this plants, so they'll be sipping this alkaloid rich sap from that particular plant. Okay. So that they'll be getting certain chemicals to attract the females better. Okay. So what this moth will be doing is, you can see on the top picture is the eggs of that particular moth on that Crotalaria plant. And once the eggs are hatched, they'll be start eating the tender leaves and stem of that particular Crotalaria plant. So that once the stem or leaves are cut, the butterflies will be getting an easy access to sip the sap from that plant. Okay. So actually they are helping each other. So so more and more butterflies will be coming on this particular plant. Okay. So you can see the freshly emerged the moth also there. So basically they are helping each other. So even though the caterpillars are there, the butterfly is not distracted, or butterfly, the caterpillars are not distracted because they are helping each other. Okay. So another I mean, interesting thing about this particular tiger moths are, so they're the pupa, how they are forming their pupa. Usually their pupa will be forming inside a case. Okay. So in, they'll be keeping some in the, they'll be weaving some net around the pupa, and they'll be pupating inside. Okay. So basically it is doing like that to avoid any, I mean, potential, the wasp or something. So usually wasp and all will be laying a egg inside this caterpillar or the pupa, and where they'll be growing, eating the pupa or caterpillar inside, and they'll be completing their life cycle. So usually if they're, the wasp are laying egg, then it'll be difficult for them to survive. Okay. So they have to, I mean, avoid any wasp or attacking this particular pupa. So they are keeping a particular distance from the it. So they are, you can see they are protected from, with a case, so that the wasp and all cannot easily go there and, I mean, lay egg inside the pupa. Or so that is the one peculiarity of the tiger moth. So in the here also, in the previous slide also, in the last picture, you can see there is a pupa. So they are forming inside a case. So that's a family, the tiger moths. Okay. So this is the another colorful of set of moths. Okay. So this moth, some of them you can see even in cities, from the, they'll be coming in the light at home. Okay. So these are known as the Lithocini tribe, so, or lichen moths or lichen moths. So they'll be eating, actually the, they are not feeding on the plants, or they are not feeding on the leaves in the early stage. You can see in the bottom there is a caterpillar. So usually they'll be laying egg on the wet floors, or I mean wet walls, or the wet tree barks and all, where they can eat the lichens, or so that they can, I mean, they'll be breeding by eating that one. So you can see that all the moths are not feeding on the, or breeding on the leaves or plants. Okay. Some of them are, I mean, surviving with the eating the fungus or the even lichens. Okay. This is another interesting group. Okay. This is known as the Bombycidae. Okay. And you can see one of the famous, the commercial moth. Okay. So commercial moth, I'm saying the silk moth. Okay. So Bombax mori. So that's a, I mean, one of the I mean, commercially available moth in India. So it is using for producing silk. And you can see the shape of this particular, I mean, the shape of wing of this particular moth is different from others. You can see that particular, the axe shape of, for the four wings, and the hind wing is actually is very small and diluted, and it is having a stout body. Okay. So this is known as the Bombycidae family. So this is also quite common. Okay. So next time when you are seeing this particular group, you can see with this shape of this particular moth. Okay. So I mean, even some of the silk moth, you can see some, I mean, the they are commercially cultivating this silk moth. Okay. And this is a famous, the owl moth. Okay. So this is seen in the Himalayas and all. So this is the Brahmin moth, or the Brahmini velici. So that is the owl moth we are saying. So this is the, I mean, you can see it is having a owl look. Okay. And we have some more that similar species in the South India also. Okay. And this is another family. So this is a Calludulidae. So it is basically a butterfly mimicking moth. Okay. You can see the pictures is quite similar to butterflies. Okay. But these are actually moths. So how we identify is by looking the antenna. You can see that the antenna usually won't lie. So this is a moth. Okay. So this Tetragonus catamatus is a common species in South India also, and some of the forested regions you can find it. Okay. So even in the Himalayas or Northeast, there are a lot of records of this particular moth. Okay. So this is the family, so they are actually mimicking the butterfly. Yeah. The another one is the Cosidae family. You can see they are having some rolled, the structures, and they are not colorful. They are usually coming in black and white. Okay, so these are known as the carpenter millers. Okay, you can see on the top there is, I kept a picture of caterpillar. So usually they'll be boring the dead woods, or the, that is why it is known as carpenter millers. So they'll be boring the dead trees, or the dead, the the, even the timber part they'll be boring it. And this particular category is known as the Cosidae, and actually they are having a slightly dull color, and they'll be having a usually bigger body, and the wings are when sitting the wings are very compact. Okay. So this is the grass moths. Okay, so grass moths are quite common. Okay, so even when you are just going out through your garden, or just any trail, if you are walking through grass, you can see some of the moths are popping out, and you can see, you are familiar with this type of caterpillars also. So on the top corner, I kept a caterpillar picture. So that is of a grass moth. So this family is known as Crampidae. Okay, and they are breeding basically on the small plants and grasses. Yeah, that is why these are known as the grass moths. And usually they are confining very close to the ground, so they may not be fly too high or too far. So usually if you are disturbing it also, they'll be just sinking into some of the grass blades, or they'll be hiding under some grass blades. Okay. So you can see a few more the moths here. And one thing is that particular shapes. So usually when they are sitting, they are sitting in that triangular shape, or sometimes they'll be sitting with their wings open. Okay. So that is the grass moths. So this is a big group. So we have a lot of moths in this particular group. So in this particular family, and if you are carefully documenting, you can easily document some 20 or 30 moths in your surrounding area. Okay. So that are the grass moths, and you can see the particular shape when they are sitting. The idle, they'll be closing the wings and all, so they'll be keeping it the compact. Otherwise, they'll be sitting with their spreaded wings. Okay. So these are also from the same family, some other moths. So I just given some names. Okay. Actually, I'm not going to all the reading of the names. Okay. So the middle one is known as the rice leaf roller. Okay. So that is considered as a pest in the the paddy field and all. And some of these moths are considered as pests because they'll be breeding on some of the plants or some of the trees which we are cultivating. So, and some of them may be having some outbreaks also. So the people are using the pesticides and all to control some of these moths. Okay. So sometimes there will be outbreaks of some moths, so we cannot help that time. That time the farmers may be using pesticides and all, but if you are learning more and if you are knowing the mechanism, we'll be having better techniques to control them. Okay, so actually I started with some of these moths. Okay, these are actually from the same family, and you can see how colorful they are. Okay, so they are basically these colorful moths, they'll be flying in the daytime. Okay, so daytime it will be more attractive, and they can hide in the flowers or the beautiful surroundings. Okay, but usually the moths which are coming at night are usually slightly duller or dull in color. Okay, so this is also from the grass moths family. Okay, I just shown more pictures to get it the idea about the moths. So than telling the IDs, I can just see some of the moths. That's what I thought. Okay, so I'll just take some more questions. So do moths, caterpillars also have several instars like butterfly catches? Do Yes, definitely. They are all from the Lepidoptera, so that mean they'll be following the similar structure as or similar lifestyle as the butterflies. Yeah. So the some moths, how you can the spot it at night. So some people are using the the lights to attract the moths. Okay. So usually they are attracted to light. Okay. So in the if you are using in the controlled environment and all, you can attract them with the moths, but make sure that you are not causing much troubles to moths. Usually when you are keeping lights and all, a lot of moths may come, and then lot of predators like the lizards or the frogs also will come along with them. So be make sure that you are doing it for only certain time, and you are doing it in a controlled environment. So that is what the how you will be looking it. Okay. Our moths are destructive as frog and grain stalk pest. Okay. Some of the moths are actually pests. Okay. Some of them you can see even in the your grain stalk, some of the moths are growing up. So whole idea is to how to control it, how to naturally control them. So that is the key.
My moths are attracted to light.
Okay. So told them, so moths are usually coming in the night. So they normally wherever the light shows, they'll be attracting towards it. So now we have a lot of city lights and all. Earlier, it was considered as they are moving towards the moonlight. Okay. So that is the idea. Now wherever they are seeing some good light source, they'll be more attracted to that one. So that is their natural natural biological movement. Okay. So the number of moths in India, it is estimated that around 10,000 species will be there in India, whereas the butterflies will be having only 1,200-1,300 range. Okay. So do moths hibernate in cocoon stage? Some of them will be hibernating in the even in egg stage, some of them in the larval stage, and some of them in cocoon stage, depending on the climatic conditions. Basically, suppose in the if the climate is too cold, some of them may be hibernating for long. So you can see some of the European moths and all, they'll be sleeping throughout the entire winter season. Okay, so I told I kept the Arctic day tiger moths under the Erebidae. So I told I'm not going as per the actual classification. That's what I just mentioned. So I'm just taking some of the moths together. I just put some the moths together. That will be easier for the the beginners. So the lifespan of Atlas moths, usually as an adult, it will be surviving a few weeks, and if you are in captivity, they may be surviving longer. Okay, usually if there is not much the potential attacks and all, they may be surviving more. Okay, so fruit piercing moth I'll be showing later. Okay, so it is coming in this slide. Okay, the identification of moths are difficult than butterflies. We are saying that the diversity is more. Okay, is something like mud puddling in moths. Okay, so some moths are having different characteristics. They may be sitting in the rotten fruit, or they may be sitting in dead the creatures, or they may be even sitting in some the wet patches. Okay. Our moth migrate. Some of the moths are migrating. Actually, we don't have much idea about the moths in India, but some of the European moths and all, they are documented migrating from one place to another. Okay. So why can't some adult moths feed in adult stage? So they are not wasting their time and energy in looking for food. So they have the main task is to reproduce and they make more younger ones. So they'll be naturally they have lost their mouth parts. Can you tell about Microlepidoptera? So actually they are very small micro moths. So they are coming under moth category. They'll be falling in what category? So actually it's a subsection of that. Okay, why caterpillars of moths usually having larger size? Okay, so that depends. Okay, so usually mean the moth caterpillars having lot of hairy mean structure, they are having mean the a woolly structure, that's why you are looking at bigger. So usually the if you are considering the weight, they are almost same as the butterflies. How can we differentiate the caterpillars? Okay, so caterpillars, I'll be showing some basic difference. I'll be showing. Okay, so is there any moths which do not have proboscis? Yes. So that's what I told. The Achilles moths and all don't have the mouth parts. Do moths die during the process of mating? Naturally, not. But some circumstances it may be there. Okay. Is there any general difference between male and female? No. Some species, it is clearly distinctive. They are having different colors, different structures and all. But some species, it is too difficult to distinguish. Okay. Then I'll just go back to the presentation and we'll come back for the questions and session. Okay, so we were just talking about some of the groups. Okay, so this is the Drepanidae. Drepanidae, actually it is known as the hook tip moth. Okay, so you can see the wing tips are like hooks, so that is why it is known as Drepanidae. And some of the other moths also in that category, so you can see some forewing is folded one, so that is also a hook tip moth. Okay, so actually I was talking about tiger moths. So tiger moths are coming under actually Eribidae, that's a super family. So they are having the large number of moths, and they are usually the medium sized moths. Okay, so medium sized means you can say the wingspan will be some 5-6 centimeters or is slightly bigger also. Okay. And they are having some particular shape. While sitting, they'll be sitting in that particular shape, and they are having medium size. Okay, so these are the Eribidae moths. Okay, and some of the Asota species moths. So these moths, some of you may be familiar. The first one is the dot underwing moth, and the second one is a sort of ficus moth. So these are having lot of moths under this particular group. So this first one is the Asota caricae, that is feeding usually on the fig fruit or fig trees, okay, or the Hispida trees. So you can see the caterpillars will be usually hairy, and usually they'll be breeding on different the ficus species or a different similar species. Okay, so this is the beautiful moth. So sometimes at your home they may be coming. They are distributed even in most of the cities. Okay, this is a slightly tougher group. So this is known as the monkey moth or Eupetoroidae. So you can see, if you are carefully seeing, there is a monkey like face on the back of that moth. So that is why it is known as monkey moth, and it's a slightly tougher category to distinguish because most of the moths will be looking similar. Okay, and their caterpillar picture I shown in the bottom line. Okay, so in the middle one you can see a congregation of lot of caterpillar together. Okay, some moths are breeding as single caterpillars. Okay, whereas some of them breeding as group. Okay, so basically this differentiation is coming on how the survival rate is. Okay, so sometimes the breeding as single will be increasing the survival on some smaller plants and all. If they are sitting together, they are easy to spot for the predators like birds or lizards. Okay, but some moths having large number of caterpillars growing together, so they may be increasing their survival rate. Okay, so that is why some moths are breeding as single caterpillar or some of them are group. Okay, so So this is the geometry day, okay, or geometric moths. Yeah. These are very common moths. Some of them, maybe they're even at your home now. Okay. You can check at your light. In the balcony or in the porch, you can see some of them. Maybe they will be attracted to light. Okay. So this usually sitting like this. Okay. So that is the standard the posture of these moths. Okay. They'll be sitting with their wings close to their ground or the surface where they are sitting, and the forewing wing will be longer and hind wing will be shorter. So these are the geometry day moths. Okay, why it is not geometry day is, you can see this is the basic characteristics of their caterpillars. Okay, so you can see in the middle there are no legs for this caterpillars, or no legs or prolegs. Okay. So they'll be moving like this. You can see how they are moving now. So I've kept a sequence of pictures. They'll be just making some loop and they'll be moving forward. Okay. So earlier, they were known as they are measuring earth by inch. So that is what the name came as, the geometry day. Okay. They are measuring the earth by inch, or the earth measures. That is what it is known as, the geometry day. And they are well known for their camouflage. So on some plants, you cannot identify this caterpillar easily, because there'll be the resembling the plant or tick. So they cannot be easily recognized. Okay. So next time when you are going to the field, you try to get spot some of these moths, caterpillars. Okay. So these are again from the same family. So all these are the geometry day family. So you can see the shape, and the one with the white bar on the bottom, second one. Okay. So that is a Diasmia species, so which are very common in almost all the places here. Okay. So these are the family geometry day. Another family is the Lasiocambidae family, and here you can see the moths are slightly stout, okay, and usually the hairy, and sometimes even their legs are hairy, the forelegs and all, they are hairy. Okay. So one of the very famous moth is the first one, the Trabala Vishnu. Okay. So that's the caterpillar of that one is shown on the top right. Okay. So it is also known as the Vishnu moth. Okay. So Trabala Vishnu, here the male and female are different in colors. So the first one, the green one, is the male, and the immediate next, the yellow one is its female. So one question was there whether you can identify male and female. Yes, in some species you can identify, but not in all. Okay. Some of them having a clear distinction between male and female in some families, but in some families it is not. Okay. So these are the Lasiocambidae. So you can see the caterpillar also having some the mustache like thing to forward. Okay. Another one is the Limacodidae family. So Limacodidae family moths. Actually, this is the caterpillar of the one of such Limacodidae family, and these caterpillars are basically very allergic. Okay. If you are touching it, it may cause it may sting very badly, and it may cause the very serious the reactions or serious allergies. Okay. The caterpillar may be looking very very attractive, very colorful. Sometimes it'll be so cute. Okay, but don't try to touch such caterpillars, because some of them may be causing serious allergies, or if you are touching it, it will be causing some burning sensation, or if some people are allergic to that, it may be causing more troubles. So sometimes you have to consult a doctor to get the proper treatment. Okay. So the moths from that family are shown here. So usually they are smaller moths with some stout body and all. So the first one is the top left one is the Parasa Lepida, and that caterpillars are shown here. Okay. So these are the caterpillar. They are breeding as a group on the castor plant. Okay. So another one is the tussock moth. Okay. So this is the first picture when you are coming, talking about moths. This is the first picture of the caterpillar which is coming to usually into your mind. There, the caterpillars are itchy. So you can see some tuft or some rice portion on the caterpillar back. Okay, that is why it is known as the tussock moth or tufted moth. Okay, this is from the Limantridae family, and there are a lot of moths in this, falling in this group. Okay, so but you can see easily the caterpillars in the field. So many of the caterpillars are we are seeing around maybe from this family. Okay, so these are some somebody asked about the fruit piercing moth. Okay, so some moths will be feeding on the nectar, or some maybe on the rotten objects and all, but some of them may be feeding on the fruit. Okay, actually this fruit piercing moths, they are having a strong proboscis that they'll be the drilling the fruit, and they'll be sipping the juice from the fruit. Okay, so some of these moths are considered as pest in some the pomegranate farms, all that things. They'll be actually drilling hole in the pomegranate, and they'll be sitting. Actually, on the top left picture, you can see one moth is drinking juice from a fruit. Okay, and these caterpillars of this moth also are interesting. You can see they are having some fake eyes on the body, and they are, when you are disturbing it, they'll be sitting in a defensive posture. So usually with this posture, they can actually divert the birds and all. So they'll be imitating like some snakes and all, so that the birds or some small predators may not come easily to this moth. Okay. So these are the Eudocyma family. So they are the fruit piercing moths. Okay. There are a few moths in this category. So you can see in them in the the fruit orchards and all, you can see them. So another one is the Noelidae family. Actually, these moths are slightly smaller. Okay, but on jamun trees. Okay, so the jamun trees and all, you can.
Jamun, daddy.
Hello.
Hello. Okay. Please mute everyone. Hello. Okay. Please mute.
Okay. So on jamun trees, you can see some of jamun the caterpillar with some big head.
Jamun, okay. Jamun.
So usually, it is known as the pus head moth. Okay. So there is some pus-like thing on the head. Okay, so that are the one easier identification for the Noelidae moths. Okay, so that are known as the pus-head moths. Okay, so usually on the jamun trees you can see some such caterpillars. Okay, and this is another interesting family. So you can see the caterpillar on the top. So it is known as a lobster moth. Okay, usually we are calling it as lobster moth, because you can see the caterpillar is having legs and the horns like some lobster. Okay, and when you are disturbing it or it is feeling threat, it'll be acting. It'll be in a defensive pose, that so it'll be mimicking a lobster. Okay, so some of the moths from this family is shown. Okay, they are not quite attractive, but their caterpillars are quite interesting. So this is a family Notodontidae. So they are slightly bigger moths. Okay, but their caterpillars are interesting. Okay, somebody asked this question. So usually when you are storing the rice or the wheat or the dal or something, so usually you can see some of the moths are flying out of that. Okay, so some moths from this Pyrrhelidae family, so they'll be breeding with some available material there. So you can easily, they'll be easily completing their life cycle. Within few days, they may be completing their life cycle. Or when we are storing the grains in some places, sometimes the eggs of that, the moths may be with them, so that even if you are storing in some close place safely, so sometimes some moths may come out. Or if you are storing it for long, so the probability of having more moths or more the worms are more. So this is some notorious moths. Yeah, there are different moths in this category. So the since it, they are very small, the identification also slightly difficult because they are quite smaller. The features, all the features, you cannot easily capture with the photos and all. Okay. So these are the bigger ones. Okay. So Saturni Day. Okay. So you can see the Emperor moth, the that is the first one, and the Lunar moth. Okay. So the it is known as the Lunar moth because you can see on the four wings there is a moon-like marking or crescent-like markings. Okay. So that is why they are known as Lunar moth, and they are beautiful, colorful, and they are will be usually having some long tails. Okay. And the bottom left one is a Atlas moth, that's the biggest moth, and the bottom right one is a Tassar silk moth. So basically it's a silk moth. Okay. And the caterpillar shown here is of an Atlas moth. Okay. I mentioned earlier that the Atlas moth doesn't have a mouth part. Okay. So usually in the caterpillar stage they'll be eat a lot. Okay. So usually they'll be finishing lot of leaves or lot of branches in a one day when they are in the advanced stage. Okay. When about to pupate, they'll be eating too much and they'll be storing all that energy as fat, and which will be utilized in the adult stage. So that is why these moths are known as the known for they don't have any mouth parts, or they won't feed in the adult stage. Okay. So this is the one beautiful picture I actually one of our friends she posted in the Facebook today. So I asked her permission to use this one. So these are the Saturnidae moths. Most of them are Saturnidae moths. You can see the one or two, the Lunar moths are there, Atlas moths are there, the Emperor moth is there. So she posted today, so I asked her permission to use it in the presentation. So it looks nice. So okay. So the Hawk moths, so some of biggest moths in the group. Okay. So it is known as Hawk moth because you can see the cross wing represent a hawk, or is a insane arrow shape one. So that is why they are known as the hawk moth. So these are bigger moths. Usually their body will be stout, and some of you may be knowing the oleander hawk moth. There is the green one on the second row, the last one, that is the oleander hawk moth. Okay. So that is usually you can find in your garden. They may be eating on your oleander plant, or they may be eating on your plants. Okay. Usually they are feeding on the milkweed plants. Okay. So that is the oleander hawk moth, and the middle one with some two eyes you can see, that is known as the death head hawk moth. Okay. Acernodia species. Okay. So and there is a skull-like structure or skull-like shape on the back of that moth. So that is why it is known as death head hawk moth. Okay, because that resembles a skull. Okay. So usually the interesting thing about this moth is usually this moth will steal honey from the honeycomb. Okay. Usually the honeybees are the very possessive about their they'll be protecting their hives very strictly, but these moths will slowly imitate their pheromones, and they'll be slowly entering into the honeycombs, and they'll be stealing the honey from it. Okay. So that's an interesting moth. Okay. And the last one is another hawk moth. Usually we are calling it is hummingbird hawk moth. Okay. There are few species in that one. This is known as a coffee bee. Coffee bee hawk moth, because you can see they are having a clear wing, so it's also known as some clear wing moths. Okay, so that comes under the Sphingidae family or hawk moths. Okay, and few more hawk moths here. Okay, so the first one is a set of Marumba species and some Hipposcion species, the Peretra, and one more Acernatia species, and last one is the I told it is known as the hummingbird hawk moth. So you can see it is something like a hummingbird. So it is sipping the nectar, quite similar to a hummingbird. Okay, so then I'll take some questions. Okay, so this is the one which you are seeing in your room. Even you are painted well, if you are maintaining your room well, sometimes you can see some of the moths are moving around here. And the top right one is a caterpillar of that one. So you can see on your table or corner of your room, sometimes they are there. They are the tiniest moths, or sometimes they even grow on the clothes which you are storing. So they'll be eating the cloth parts, okay, fibers on the clothes, and they'll be growing. So that is the tinidae family, and they are very tiny moths. Okay. So they almost grow everywhere. So one or two. So this is the Uranidae family. So the in the northeast you can see the Lysa samba, the bottom middle one. Okay. So that's a big solar tail moth. Okay. And the first one is a Micronia acculeata. That's a very common one in most of the South India. Okay. So these are the Uranidae family and the. This is the Barnard moth. The antenna similar to that of a butterfly. Usually, I told you can easily distinguish them with their antenna. But here, the antenna is also something very quite similar to that of a butterfly. Yeah. So some of them are day flying also. So it may be causing confusion whether it is a butterfly or a moth. Okay. And usually its caterpillars having some the projections on their body. So you can see they are having beautiful the caterpillars. Okay. So I'll take some quick questions and then I'll go to the last session. Okay, I'm just getting where I stopped. Okay, some mouthless you said are any carnivorous moth. Okay, carnivorous means basically some moths may be eating dead creatures or dead snakes they may be feeding on. They're not any carnivores. They may not directly kill anything and eat. Okay. So moths are classified in scheme. So are any moths in scheduled we don't have the complete database of the moths. So presently not much the learn about the moth, so we don't have any scheduled species now. Okay, how to identify a butterfly and moth caterpillar, I'll come to that. Is there any species found in dry areas? So you can see that moths are everywhere. Okay. So if the vegetation is more in that areas, you can find the more numbers, but moths are everywhere. You can see even in your rice bag, even in your room, everywhere it is there. So even in dry area, you have a lot of moths, but diversity depends on the how much vegetation you are having. So usually more vegetative area the vegetation area you'll be having more moths. Okay, so there is a question about the oleander hawk moth. They are breeding on the poisonous plants, okay, some of them oleander plants and all, they are not used. So when they are the breeding on some of these plants, usually the chemicals from these plants will be storing in their bodies, so they may not be, I mean, the preferred by the predators. So that is the one reason why they are choosing some poisonous plants. Another reason is to control that plant, so the nature is finding some ways. So that's one. Okay, some moths are plant specific. They are breeding on the hibiscus plant. Okay. Okay, is the moths only cause allergies, or they carriers of some diseases? Okay, so that means some moths are allergic to some people. Okay, so I mean not only caterpillars, some moths having some the hairs, scales and all that are allergic to some people, but not all. Okay, and whether they are carrying some disease, we don't know exactly, because there can be some micro or organism, or there can be some mean the viruses on something, but generally I mean the risk is same as all other creatures. Okay, the moths and butterfly you cannot identify with the body structures. Okay, so the body shapes and all different for different families. So the percentage of pollination of moths and comparing with bats, so that we didn't study much. That is what we can say, because I mean we didn't study much in the nightlife. We didn't study much in the pollination of plants at night and all. So we have to do a lot more the studies to conclude something on this. Okay, some caterpillars try to attack. So when you are the disturbing them. So definitely they'll be having some defense mechanism there to they protect their lives. So they'll be having some defense mechanism there. Sometimes they'll be sitting in a defensive pose, sometimes they'll be secreting some solutions, sometimes they'll be creating some bad smell. All that things are common in the moths and butterflies. Okay, so that is their the survival technique. Okay, are fruit bears in moths considered as pests? Yes, if you are, the number is more, it should be considered as pest, because in the I told in the pomegranate farms or mango farms, if too many number are there, then it should be considered as a pet. Some moths pupate underground. Is there any reason for it? So usually the moths will be pupating in a safer place. Okay, so when they are ready to pupate, they'll be pupating in the in a safe and secure place. So some of them may be preferring on the trees or bark, or some of them may be even going under the soil or the foliage, because it is more safer. Okay, so usually the moths which are having longer the pupal duration, they'll be going underground. Okay, so some books for moth identification, I'll be just talking about some the websites. Okay, so the that is better now than some of the books. I'll suggest some books also. Okay, any moths are venomous or poisonous? Okay, so that's a one point. So in you can see some of the some cultures, they are using the caterpillars as their the their food. So some moths are edible in that way. Okay, but some of them are the causing allergy, all that thing. So the some of them may not be good for to touch or the to approach. Okay, the book I'll be sharing some the websites and all, so that you can. Any cannibalism found in moths? No, moths are comparatively the very calm and quiet, so we didn't have any cannibalism, but they may feed on the dead parts and all. The moth population affected by the use of pesticides? Yes, they should be affected, but we don't have the clear numbers, so that is why. So in some areas at least it is the number is definitely affected. Okay, so then I'll quickly go back. So because they already we have it's more than 1 hour, so I'll be trying to be a bit quick. Okay, so I'll just go through some early stages. Okay, so these are the some pictures for the butterfly eggs. Okay, so usually the you cannot easily identify them, but if you are having some idea, then you can say that these are the moth eggs. Okay, so whether how it is different from bugs and all, some with some experience you can identify. But you can say some of them may be laying egg on the leaves, some of them may be on the plant, some of them on the twigs, but some of them on even ground or even on wet floor. I told some of them may not be feeding on the plants. Okay, so this is the general caterpillar structure. This is same as the butterflies. They'll be having some forelegs, some hind legs, and some prolegs in between. Okay, so I'll just show some characteristics. So usually the last part, the marked as 10. Okay, so that is the anal prolog or the last pair of the prolog. So that will be prominent in moths. So that is the one way you can identify the moths. The last the prologs will be more prominent in moths than butterflies. Okay, so that claspers which we are calling, so that claspers are the one key to identify the moth and butterfly caterpillars. So these are some moth caterpillar. I'll just show. So these left ones are some Pteroptera caterpillar. Some Geometridae is there. Some the tussock moth is there, and one lobster moth you can see. And the left one you can see some of them are hiding inside the some cells, or some of them making their own cells with the available materials which are finding around. Okay. So and some of them may be having the hairs, and some of them may be having the tufts on the body, and usually the haired ones are maybe causing itchy, or they usually visually also not so attractive. So they don't touch any caterpillar as such. Okay, so don't handle them directly. So you observe them, you can click pictures, you can share them. Okay, and these are the some of the pupa pictures. Okay, so the first one is of a convolvulus hook moth. You can see a jug-like structure. It's a slightly bigger one, so 1 or 2 inch size. Okay, and the second one is a grass moth. You can see that it's pupated on grass, and some tiger moths, they are pupating inside some case. Okay, and the some atlas moth and all, they'll be making some cover and they'll be pupating inside. So the basic idea is that it has to be protected through that pupal stage, because that is the immobile stage. There is no defense there, so they have to protect themselves in a safer place. Okay, so that's a pupal stage. Okay, so this is some overall idea about the life stages. Okay, so I'll be sharing some links. So there is a there are few links available in India. The moths of India is the moth site, actually it's based on India, so I'll be just showing that one. Okay, so this is Moths of India website. Okay, so there you can see some around 1200 species are all now covered there. Okay, so you can see some of the pictures there. So this is a curated website, so there they'll be peer reviewing the you can submit your pictures with the details where you clicked, when you have clicked. Okay, and then they'll be comparing the IDs and they'll be putting it. But I told it is not completely, they cannot completely identify the moths now, because they are also having some limitation. So some of the moths, they are identifying it. There are some life cycle documentation also there. You can just click and see some of the life cycles there. Okay, some moth life cycles are there. Some of them are documented well. Okay, so this is the Moths of India website. So it is it is slowly developing. Okay, so it is not completely developed, it is slowly developing. So you can see and you can identify some of the modes there. Okay, another one is the one useful site is the Moths of Borneo. So even though it is not an Indian site, or it is the moths are not from India, but the most of Indian moths are covered there. Okay, so that's a well designed site and lot of details are there. So this is the Moths of Borneo website, and you can see there are lot of volumes are there. So they are having lot of pictures. Okay, so there are lot of galleries, lot of color plates. So this is the way they are documented it. Okay, so this is a good source. You can depend for your some, if you have some idea, you can see which family to check on and all. You can go there and check whether you can identify your moths. So you can see that it's a very good website. It's a one of the reliable website. That's a Moths of Borneo. And next one is the Moths of Taiwan. Okay, so I told, even though it is not Indian, but most of the moths are in the Oriental region is covered there. Okay, so it's a Moths of Taiwan website. So here you can see some of the species. Okay, some of the categories. You can click any one and you can see which are the, you can see lot of pictures and lot of descriptions are there. Okay, so and this is one of the thing site which you can check for. Okay, Moths of Moth Taiwan. Okay, and the one Indian field guide is one bird wing field guide to Indian moths by Subbalakshmi is there. So that recently they released 2 years back. So it covered many moths, and also they are given some easier common names. Okay, so one reason which is restricting the moth study is the non availability of common names. So some of the common names are covered there. So as a the field guide to Indian moths by Subbalakshmi Mana. And the another one, the Indian moths, you have lot of in the forums in the Facebook or the social media website. So there is a Facebook group for Indian moths. There, many of your friends online are already the members there. So there the mechanism is we are helping each other. Some of them, so most of the moths may get identified there. Okay, so not all, but most of them will be getting identified. Okay, so another one I'll show you. I'll be just closing with that one. This is the Facebook page of the Mr. Valavasanam Mulapil. So he's from Kerala. So he's studying the life cycles of moths very seriously. So he recently updated a lot of pictures there. So I'll just show some life cycle pictures because he's having a lot of collection. You can just see some of it. It is there. Okay, because he documented with very good pictures. Yeah, so and he documented it very well. Yeah. Okay, so the pictures of some of the moths early stages. Yeah, so you can see there. I'll be sharing PPT, or this PPT will be online also. You can see the early stages of moths. Some of the moths you may be knowing, the caterpillar you may be familiar with. Okay, but you can see how the moths and caterpillars are connected there. This is the lily moth. Okay, so this, it may be eating your lilies. So this is the moth and this is a caterpillar. Okay, so you can see the lot of the resources available now. Okay, now what I'll be concluding with, what you have to do. Okay, so I told already. So you have to help the science by clicking the moths. So wherever the moths you are seeing, you try to click it. Okay, so if not now, you may be getting it identified in later stage. So you can share in the some public platform, like something like the iNaturalist. Yeah. So iNaturalist is a citizen science platform where you can post all your the observations. Yeah. So you can see, you can have a small account and you can just post your observations. So with some date and time, or most of the details, it will be automatically taking it. So there are a lot of experts from across the globe. So they may be identifying it. And if more than, few experts are getting it identified, they'll be converting it as a research-grade document. That means the moth which you are seeing at home, it is going to the public domain, or it is going into the research community. So anybody can find that particular the data or that particular observation. So that is the way now the science is growing. So it is showing where it is clicked and what time it is, which season, which month. So everything, it is automatically getting it. So that it is getting a big data. Suppose you are getting a moth today at your home. So in this month, in this season, so this particular moth is sighted in this region. Yeah. So after 2 years, somebody is sighting from some nearby places, he can see that some similar sighting was there in the nearby place. So that is how the science grows. That is how the growth is happening. So you all have to contribute. You can even the iNaturalist having the mobile apps, so you need not worry much. You can just click the picture and you can upload from the mobile phone itself. Okay. So a lot of flexibility is there. So you can start uploading some of the records there, or any of the similar platforms. Okay. So there is the Project Noah is there, all that. Okay, so with this, I'll just stop the formal session. Then I'll go to the discussion forum, so you can have some more questions there. So do the caterpillars have simple eye while the adult moth? So this is, that mechanism is similar in butterflies and moths. So usually the caterpillars are having smaller eyes, and then they are growing, they will be having bigger one. Okay. So so most of the hairy caterpillars, okay, which you are seeing are basically of moths, most of them, not all, okay, but most of them are moth caterpillars. Okay. So any more questions, then I can be there for some more time. Okay. So I think the presentation will be available in the Facebook, and they are recording it. If any more questions, then I can take. Otherwise, we'll be stopping here. So thank you so much for all the participants. Okay. So the special thanks to the coordinators, Kottayam Natural History Society, Alappi Natural History Society, and the special thanks to David Raju, who compelled me to take this session, because he has compelled me to take on the moths. Okay. So I know I have only limited knowledge in the area of moths, okay, but he compelled me. So thank you all the coordinators, Hari sir, the Badush, the Sri Kumar sir, thank you so much for giving me an opportunity. Okay. So I'll be on Facebook, so you can contact me. Some of them may be having my phone numbers also. Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Hanish. Yes. Check a button.
Okay.
Thank you on behalf of Kottayam Nature Society and Alappi Natural History Society. Probably we can go through some more question there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, is there any data to say that moths face a population decline? No, some moths are studied, not in India, but in some Western countries and all, some moths, the life they are studied. So some moths are facing serious threat because, you know, lot of threat for their life, the habitat reduction, the pesticides, and the lot of other, the urbanization, all that things. So some moths, the ants are definitely declined. Okay, but we don't mean much study done in India. What is the best way to study their classification? So what we can do is, the some of the easier groups you start studying, slowly you can pick up from the other groups. Okay, so there is no direct shortcut. Okay, so you can join in some of the forums, or you can regularly check some of the updates, so that you'll be getting some idea. So I mean you cannot easily learn everything together, so slowly you can automatically you can learn. So you can learn in some the forums, and you can share your information. We cannot say that we have found a new species, but there is a probability that it may be a new species, because we have only a few records. Okay, so lot of moths may not be completely described even in Kerala or even in South India. So that are the areas where more studies are done. Okay, so in some of the moths, maybe sometimes it may be new. Okay, that is the reason why we are telling to document everything. So even if it is not a new, so it will be definitely a new record from your area, because most of the areas are still uncovered.
Okay.
I think no more question. I think I'll invite Dr. Krishna Kumar from Kottayam Nature Society and Alappi Naturally Society to give a vote of thanks. Sir, are you there?
I'm here. I'm audible?
Yeah, yes, audible, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. I am Krishna Kumar, representing both the societies, Alappi Natural History Society and Kottayam Nature Society, here to thank you, Mr. Hanish. Mr. Hanish, you are most unassuming, but having a very vast knowledge of a very unexcavated area of moths. And not only exhaustive, but you have covered all the future possibilities for the beginner as well. So where to post the photos, where to get more information, where to get it documented, all these things. So in every respect, this class was exemplary, I would say. And I extend our thanks for you for coming over here and spending this much time with we people. We are all beginners, and your class was excellent. Once again, on behalf of all present here, I thank you, Mr. Hanish. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.